When he was about 2.5 years old, we noticed that he had stopped talking. You make me cry already. Stopped talking. He wasn't looking at you when you talked to him. He just seemed like he was just in his own little world. And we took him to the doctor for a 3-year checkup. And the doctor at his checkup said he shows signs of having autism and referred us to the regional center, and it kind of all started there when he was 3. And I walked out of the doctor's office just not knowing what to do and feeling alone. And that day changed our lives forever.
And not knowing anyone that had autism.
Right. And at that time, my perception of autism was mental retardation. I didn't know anything about autism. And you know, it's not like that at all. I didn't know anything about it, but now I do. I learned a lot.
We noticed when he was really little, I mean, less than a year old, we used to just say he was quirky. I mean, and then when he, I don't know, he was either just doing weird little things or having a tantrum all the time. And as he got older, it was more and more tantrums, and they'd last for up to 2 hours. And then just funny little things like strange little hand movements and the body rocking and the banging his head on the floor. And I don't know, we just kind of thought he was just Braden being Braden. But yeah, I'd say I noticed it when he was really little. I mean, probably 7-8 months old. He was diagnosed at around 16 months, right around there. We know, I with the tantrums, because he would get really kind of violent and aggressive. So we were kind of concerned maybe about some sort of a mental health issue. So that's where I started. I took him in, and the lady said, you know, that she didn't see anything wrong in that aspect, but she was the one that recommended that we see an autism specialist to have him evaluated. And so it seems to be that was the right track. So that lady kind of knew what she was talking about. But we just knew there was something that was different. I mean, and he was just kind of different, quirky. I felt, this sounds weird, but I felt relieved because I knew there was something different. And to just kind of have an answer that, you know, okay, this is what's going on, and here's what we can do about it. It gave me hope that, okay, you know, it's not just this scary unknown thing. It's something that other people are dealing with, and people, there's stuff you can do to work with it and help, help with. And I don't know, it's just kind of a sense of relief and anxiety because you're going, okay, what's this going to mean for the world? But it was relieving.
When he was about 2, I guess, he wasn't quite meeting all the milestones that the doctors were asking about, and it was about then started realizing something might be different.
I noticed something was different about Caden probably between 4 and 6 months, when some of our friends had children and Caden didn't react in the same fashion with like recognizing facial expressions or sitting up the same way some of the other kids were developing. And it was good that we had friends that had children about his age, because we were able to kind of catch it pretty quick and start trying to get a diagnosis. And so, of course, my wife was a good proponent in going and seeking help and finding out what was wrong. I felt relieved when we got a diagnosis because, being an engineer, I want a solution and I want a problem. And so once we knew, I wouldn't say the problem, but once we knew what was going on, we were able to then redirect our efforts and focus on what he needed in order to develop good skills.
I think I noticed a difference with Caden at probably 5-6 months. At the baby shower, we got probably every book on what to expect at each month. And every single month, we would read the chapter, and nothing would apply. And I would get so frustrated because I had no idea what was going on. And then finally we took him in, and it was persistence. I mean, it wasn't like you took him in and it was fine. It was like you took him in and they said, wait, he's a boy. He developed slower. Finally, at about 9 to 12 months, they said, okay, there's something going on here. But he wasn't diagnosed until he was 2, because they wanted to wait until maybe more time went by, since he was a boy and boys develop differently. So when we did get the diagnosis at 2, I think my whole world collapsed, because I didn't think that my child was going to have special needs. I thought, I mean, we didn't think this would happen to us, and it was a big shock. And my husband said it was a relief when he found out, and I felt like it was more like a punch in the face. And I mean, I'm still reeling from it, but it's a day by day process.
I would say after Brayden was in the hospital for his seizure disorder and his diagnosis of his brain tumor, we went into the hospital, medicating him for the seizures, recording the seizures. During the recording, he's doing his normal talking and laughing, singing ABCs. After a week on the medication, we noticed him talking less, behaviors starting, just crying, just more upset. At first, we thought maybe side effects to medication. But then his seizures started getting worse, even on the medications. And he completely stopped talking. That's when we went back to the neurologist. We talked more about, obviously, we knew he had a brain tumor, but our understanding was he was talking before during these seizures. Why all of a sudden now at 3 years old is language completely gone? And I had asked several questions about possibility of autism. At that point, they didn't want to discuss that. They wanted to discuss more the brain tumor and the seizure disorder could be causing it. There's a lot of electricity going on in the brain that could be causing the prevention of language. As time went on, we started seeing even more things happening, stemming behaviors. More and more, as I researched and read like the Jenny McCarthy book, the bouncing around like a butterfly, I'm like, this is sounding more and more like autism with his seizure disorder and his brain tumor. So at that point, I got a hold of the regional center, had our meeting, and she says, I see what you're talking about. She goes, he definitely is on the spectrum. I needed that diagnosis for him for a direction other than what we were already going through with his other diagnoses in order to move on and help him get his therapy and his behavior therapies together.
Alexa has always been different. Even from the time she was born, she has never been willing to look at me in the eyes and make that connection like you hear a lot of young babies do. She never wanted me to sing to her. She would cry. Her focus was more on everything else except for the people in the room. I didn't have another child, and I don't have any family support on my side, so I didn't notice there was anything different about her for a very long time. About 6 months, I realized she wasn't playing any of the games like typical kids do. No patty cake, no singing songs, no engaging with us in any way. But not until my mother-in-law was watching my daughter did she notice that there was something significantly different. And it was probably heartbreaking for her after a week of asking her friend who worked up in Oregon in the autism spectrum to look at Alexa, that she realized that she needed to tell us that Alexa had signs of autism. Once we got the diagnosis, at 15 months, services started. So I feel like we were really, really lucky to find out as early as we did. I was relieved. I thought for the longest time that there was something wrong with me as a mother. I always felt like I was failing her in some way. But once I found out that she was simply different, she thought different, and once I learned how she thought and how she saw the world, it was much easier for me to figure out a way to help her to be happy and successful in whatever she does.
Max was always different. The thing about him that was the most striking for me is that he never liked picture books. He liked phone books. And our friends and our family, you know, from around the country would send phone books for Christmas and birthdays. And that was one of the first things that I noticed that was kind of a, you know, like a red flag. I remember when my parents came to visit us and Max was two, and when they left, my dad said, oh, he'll be talking by Christmas. And Christmas came and went and Max still wasn't talking. So that's when I made an appointment with the regional center to see if there was something else going on. And sure enough, I have a unique perspective having a parent with autism. So I wasn't all that surprised by it.
You know, Brittany pretty much developed right along the schedule until we started vaccinations. He's a little different. I am one of those people that I do believe that vaccinations affected my child. After having had a second child, I can honestly tell you that Brittany was definitely affected before. But after we got the MMR vaccination, he changed considerably. He ran a high fever for like 3 days. And after the fever broke, he would not make eye contact with us any longer. If you hugged him, it was like it hurt him for you to hug him. He would run and fall over. He was probably about 20 months when the change happened. My son is autistic with epilepsy. He started seizures at about 24 months. I was kind of hoping the seizures were the reason that he was changing the way he was. So, I mean, I remember before he got his shot, he could take a rock and he could skip it across the lake, and he can't throw a ball anymore. It's difficult for him. He just lost all these skills that he had before. And took him into the regional center and let Monica just observe him for about 20 minutes. And she said, you know, I think your concerns are founded. As parents, we're selfish, you know. We want our kids to interact with other children. We want them to play sports. We want them to go to the prom. We want them to get married. We want, you know, grandchildren. We want all those things. And you do. You get very depressed over it. But those are our dreams. They're not our children's. So once you get past that, you know, Brittany's happy. And he doesn't care about that stuff. And so it doesn't really matter.
Well, I have to say with Lily, everything was tracking on. And she was toddling and walking and, you know, doing her words and stuff, and she had a measles, mumps, rubella shot, MMR. Within a certain amount of hours, she actually came down with rubella, high temperature, and within probably about 3 days, she has lost all of her skills. So we went to her pediatrician, and they said, well, I think we need to go through some testing, give it some time, and within about 2 months, we actually went in for all the rest of the testing, and she was diagnosed with autism, so 2.5. I think it was an answer, which was good because we were concerned about other things, but it also was a little hard to handle, I think, too, just because I was that parent that said, oh no, maybe she'll just talk in a few more months. So it was good to have something that we could go from and start working towards, though.
Support means everything to me. I have a very supportive family, a husband, my parents, my in-laws, my sisters, my sister, my brother, my in-laws, yeah, they're all great and they all just want to help, and it means everything because I have another child and sometimes she has things I have to take her to and Edward has appointments, and it, just having someone there to help and help me out with the kids is, I couldn't imagine not having them all, so.
It's important to have people that are willing to have an open mind with what you're dealing with each day and be supportive of that and realize that it changes from day to day what kind of support you need, or just to be kind of flexible with the situation. And it's difficult. I mean, I'm really fortunate because I have an excellent daycare lady who, she's the one that, you know, and she's been doing daycare for 25 years, and she was the one that, even though I, you know, we already kind of noticed something was a little different, she's the one that said, you know, you might want to, you know, have someone take a look and just see what's up with them and stuff. And so she's been really supportive, having the therapist come in and work with them. She allows them to come to the daycare, and she learns from them and does whatever they suggest, and just really, you know, tapers her, you know, her whole routine around what he needs, and the other kids as well. I mean, it's really nice. But and just through like the pals and everyone like that, having just people that kind of understand it.
Well, luckily we got a good system of we got my parents and Emily's parents and lots of family, and that really helps a lot. It's good to have people that you feel comfortable leaving him with, and you can't just have a regular any old buddy be a babysitter.
Support's awesome. I don't know how parents do it without support around, because we have both sides of our family locally, and they provide a tremendous amount of relief for us when things get crazy or hectic. We're able to call them up, and they will watch the kids for a night or a few hours just to give us a break. And then they're also scheduled weekly. They help us out with childcare, which is a big bonus, not only for us, because we know who's watching our children, but also it's a financial relief too.
Support is so important. We are blessed, Chris and I, with his family and my family that live locally. We both work full time, and that's obviously a hard thing as well, because you want the best for your kids and you want to be able to do that for you themselves, but you can't, so you have to rely on other people, and you can't just choose anybody. We have a nanny, and we had to pick her out of a group of 20, and you have to choose them carefully, because this is the person that's gonna be you when you're gone at work.
Support is huge. I now have a mostly nonverbal child. I would not be able to, I'm a full-time working mom. My husband works full-time. I wouldn't be able to trust that Brayden was somewhere being cared for the way he needed to be cared for. He can't come home and tell me, so-and-so did this to me, Mom. Having him with family is huge, because they love him like I do, and they are his voice like I am for him. So to have that support, there's no words to explain how important that support is. And I'm so, so thankful for my family to have that support.
I would love to get some support from family. I don't have any on my side. My husband's family does want to be, and they are as supportive as they can be, but they're very far away. It's something that I dream about, and it's something I hope to someday have more of. But I don't have the support that I would love, so it would mean the world to me.
Support is huge. I wish I had more. I don't have a lot of free time. I love free time. And it's just usually me and Max. And Glenn works 12-hour shifts, so I spend a lot of time with just Max and me. And it would be nice to be able to do some other kinds of things.
It's huge. We are very fortunate. I have a large family on both sides, so my mother-in-law helps considerably with my son. She actually has him there for therapy 2 to 3 days a week at her house. My dad is wonderful help. My mother's help during the summertime. She works during the school year. So yeah, without family, I just don't know how we would be able to do it. You know, Brenny is a little different. He has rages. So we've looked into respite, but it's scary to consider letting somebody else take care of your child when you know what their abilities are, and that we love them, and so we're more patient when they lash out at us. But it's a whole new ball game when you're gonna put them with somebody that you don't really know, and you don't, you know, and again, my child has no voice. So, He can't say, mommy, they lost control and shook me, or whatever it is. I mean, he can't do that. He only approximates words. That's the best he can do. Just the first sound, that's about it. And he communicates with pecs is how he communicates.
Support's important. I'm very fortunate. I have a really great husband, a really awesome mom, and some close friends and family that I've acquired through FAAN. And support's important, or we wouldn't be able to get through things.
Yeah, yes and no. I never ever imagined having a child with special needs. I don't think anybody ever does. I think my dreams for him have changed. I don't know what the future holds for him. I don't know if he'll ever graduate, if he'll live on his own. You know, most of my worries are about him. And so yeah, things change, but go with the flow and what happens, happens.
That's a really good question. And that's a hard one because I know one of my biggest challenges is I spend so much time thinking about each day and how we're gonna get through this day and, you know, what, trying to think ahead to each situation and okay, what's the scenario that could unfold here and how we can head it off at the pass. And so it doesn't give you a lot of time to sit there and think about the future. No, just that he'll, you know, be able to, because he's really, really smart and everything, and I just hope that he'll be able to have the friendships and all that that makes his life really complete. I anticipate that he'll go to school and get some amazing degree and become a genius, a scientist, something. I don't know. I can retire early.
Well, yeah, like when you find out you're having a son and you have all these dreams that, you know, you're gonna be going camping and hunting and all these fun things. And you find out a couple of years later that, you know, that's none of that's meant to be. So yeah, it's a big change.
I think that I feel selfishly that they have changed, because as a mom you want your child to do everything that every typical kid does, meaning, you know, when they ask you, did Caden do t-ball or did Caden do soccer, he can't do any of those because it's not the right fit for him. So I'm so heartbroken that he doesn't get that chance, but at the same time I wouldn't change him because he's changed our lives so much. It's just, it's hard because I feel that he is so amazing and I just don't feel everyone will be able to see that. It takes longer to see that and I don't know how many people would take the time to do that.
Well, I guess with my oldest son, the dreams are graduating and making the sports teams that he wants to make. With Brayden, my dreams are hearing his voice again, him being able to talk to me, tell me what hurts, tell me what's happening in his life, his likes, his dislikes. Everything is a guessing game. And, you know, after 8 years now, I'm pretty good at guessing at what he wants. But you just have those dreams of just listening to their voice, what their voice would sound like. So yes, my dreams have changed from the normal making sports teams to watching them graduate with their class to just hearing his voice, hearing him speak to me and tell me what he wants and what he needs and what he likes and what he wants to do.
It's always been very important to me to raise Alexa to be the girl that she wants to be, because in my childhood I wasn't given the option to look at what I wanted or what I wanted to be. And so my dreams are a little more hyper-focused. They're more on a shorter scale, goals with each month. I haven't really looked into things on the long term because that's a bit overwhelming. And so right now I just have noticed that my dreams and my focus have become different in that they're all about Alexa right now.
Yeah, basically everything. Now it's just, it's more, you know, you always think you're going to travel all over the place with your children and stuff. And I think I'm just, you know, I'm just kind of living in the moment. My dreams are, I just want my kids to be happy. That's all that matters. I have a younger child who is typical, which is wonderful, you know, because, you know, Brainy's got that extra support right within the household. So, yeah, everything has changed. It's not about being, you know, living the glamorous life anymore. We call it BC, before children. you know, it's just not about that anymore. It's just about your kids being happy and healthy. Healthy is a big thing when you have a child with epilepsy.
No, I don't think so. I think that my dreams were to have a happy, healthy child, and she is happy and healthy. Autism is just one little piece of our big puzzle. And for Lily's dreams, you know, we don't know what they were because I'm not inside of her, you know, huge brain, but we're very fortunate.
He's a really, really smart boy. He's completely nonverbal, but he's able to communicate his needs by leading us to something or showing us a picture of what he needs, or you know, I don't know if he'll ever speak, but I hold out hope that he will someday, but I'm fine with it if he doesn't. He just has a smile that lights up the world, and I just love him more than anything.
Oh, there's so many things. He's so creative. So, I mean, and kids that age, you know, I mean, they just are, they have great imaginations. He just has this amazing little imagination, amazing creativity, and just leads to a very funny personality. So being around him, the things that just crack me up every day, the things he says, and I'm like, where the heck do you get this stuff from? And you know, a lot of people might not get to experience that if they're not around him enough, because it's kind of comes out just randomly and intermittently. But it's one of the funnest things, is being around him and just kind of sitting there going, oh, what's the next funny thing he's going to do or say? And there's always something that each day, if I'm kind of just having one of those days, like, oh, this day's not so great. And then you get around him and you think, I just need a break. And then he'll just bust out with the funniest thing. Like, you're tearing me apart, Mom. What? I don't know where he comes up with this stuff, but it's great because it just makes my day.
I don't think we know yet. I don't know. I don't think people understand how much that he understands. A lot of people are around him for a little while, and they don't understand that. Yeah, he can hear them and can understand what's going on, understand situations, because he can't communicate back to them. They think that he doesn't understand what's going on.
The best thing about Caden is, even though they say that, like, a lot of autistic children don't express emotion, the best thing about him is that he does express emotion to the people that he loves. So coming home from work and, you know, getting him to come up and say hi in his own way and snuggle with him and wrestle, and you know, he loves to wrestle and be outside, so that's probably the best thing a lot of people don't see, because he is very social. So when he's out in a social event, he still kind of hangs out with everybody, but they don't get to see the fact that he's loving on everybody.
That's a good question, because that's what I think about all the time, is what I see of Caden, and that people don't give him the chance to see because he can't speak. I mean, having a child that's nonverbal is heartbreaking. I mean, he's six and he doesn't talk. So everything that he does, he has to do with his body and with sounds. And I know how much he loves us, and I know how much he loves our family, and he can't say I love you, and that just, I mean, breaks my heart. But you see that he's so loving in the way that he hugs you or he kisses you, and that that just makes a world of difference.
Brayden is definitely amazing. He amazes me daily with his strength, his perseverance, getting past his brain surgery and his seizure disorder and being nonverbal but still using the single words that he does have to get his needs met, his amazing ability to memorize music, his, you can sing a song and stop partway and he's gonna finish it. He may not be able to have a conversation with you, but he can sing the rest of the song. And to me, that's just amazing. I mean, he is so happy and so loving, and he doesn't complain, he doesn't hate for anything. And to have that is truly a blessing. And I know that people that are close to him see that amazingness of him. And I know people that work with him see that, but I feel like he's such a strong-hearted child that he will do great things.
She's beautiful. Her eyes sparkle. She can read. She knows all of the planets in the solar system. She can spell, and she's only 5 years old. She's not big on other people, and she's not big on dealing with loud noises and noisy situations. But she's a quirky little scientist, and she's just brilliant. So I really think that there's going to be a place for her someday in a niche where she's really going to be successful at whatever she does.
Everything about Max is amazing.
Well, you know, he's unique in the sense that, you know, living in the hospitals a lot when he was younger, we've discovered he even has like a photographic memory. When we take him to the hospital down the city, the children's hospital, he would know miles before we did that we were close to the hospital. And he would start freaking out in the back seat, you know. It was like, and we're wondering what's going on. And then we would say, oh, there's the exit, you know. He remembers all of that stuff. And he's learned, even being largely nonverbal, he communicates in his own way. He can point, he communicates with pecs. So pretty much we have a card for everything that he needs, you know. So he's ingenuitive. He's come a long way.
Well, she's an electronic guru. She'll be programming, I think, for Apple in a few years, I'm guessing. Writing code, probably. She navigates technology world and computers, iPads and everything, like she's, you know, in her 40s. So she's amazing at technology, and she's a happy kid.
FAAN has meant everything to me. Just meeting these 9 girls on the board and making friendships with them, and some of them I know I'm going to be friends with forever, and just having these women to go to talk to, and they understand the daily struggles I may have with Edward, and they don't question me or look weird at me when I say, you know, Edward did something crazy. You know, their responses are, yeah, Caden did that yesterday, or so just being able to have these women to talk to is everything, and I love them all, and I'm so happy to be a part of this organization, and I'm happy the things that we're doing and the events that we're creating for kids with autism to attend, and it's just been a wonderful experience, and I can't wait to see what we do in the future.
Well, I have met a lot of really wonderful and amazing people through this organization, and the support. I mean, I didn't know where to go in the beginning. It's like, you know, the regional center tells you, okay, here's the school that he can go to and this and that. But meeting the other parents that are going through the same thing, and for each one of us it's different, but there's still that same common uncertainty and everything that you're going through, and having that support of other people that know what you're going through, and just unconditional acceptance has been really amazing. And then the services, I mean, like I remember back when, you know, when he was a lot younger and they'd have the events like at Bouncy Bouncy. There's no way in the world I would have ever taken him into a public forum like that on my own without the support of FAAN. Same thing with the movies, there's no way. It's such a... It's scary to take your kids into a place like that. But when you go there with all these other people who've dealt with the same fears and the same thing, and you just want to go somewhere that everyone else takes their kids and have fun, and know you can do that without people judging you and wanting to know why your kid's acting that way, and It's really pretty amazing. It opens up a whole new world for people, and then, I don't know, just helps us to share in the experiences of what the other kids get to do, and then gives the kids that opportunity to, you know, interact with each other, and you know, it's been very supportive and very much appreciated.
I think they do good work in helping out with you know, in the community, the school teachers and stuff. Yeah, they help in raising awareness.
Well, FAAN's been great because, well, there's probably three things. One is it's given my wife a way to generate support and also have support from other women that have started the group. And then it's great because it's out in the community and it's making awareness for kids with all types of autism. And it's also great too because it has events that allow the community to either participate or come out and see what's going on, what we have to deal with, and also how great the kids are, you know, that you can actually interact and have a loving kid that wants to be around you.
Well, FAAN has meant a lot to me personally. I never expected a group of these women in my life to have started a nonprofit to make a difference with children with autism. One of the big deals for us is for people to understand that something simple as going to a movie, how hard it is for our child to get in the car, how hard it is for our child to go to a theater, how hard it is for our child to sit down and watch a movie. And FAAN provides those opportunities for kids and their families. And the smallest achievement with our children makes us as parents feel like we could climb the highest mountain or run a marathon, even though I can't really run. But I mean, you feel like you can do those things because you see families and other parents around you with the exact same situation. It may be different, but in the same way, there is a similarity. And the events provide opportunities that just for our chaotic life to be okay. And just to be like, you guys will be okay. Your kids will be okay. And there's 100, 200 people out there that have the exact same story and they'll support you. So I would say FAAN is pretty amazing. And I think we do amazing things.
FAAN has meant everything to me. Being able to talk with parents that go through the things that you go through, they understand. Family, they understand, but that's not their child. So they don't have that same understanding as the group. And FAAN, I feel, gives me that strength to help others at the same time as helping myself and my child. Everyone is wonderful. We all have great opinions, and FAAN has just been the biggest support outside of family.
The world. You guys have become the family I don't have here. You've become the sisters that I miss, the people that I can turn to when I honestly don't have anybody else to share my emotions and my feelings. You've been a rock and a level of support that I could never replace anywhere else. I love FAAN. It's my heart and it's my soul.
FAAN is a great resource. I would be hard-pressed to find another group of talented and intelligent and supportive women anywhere ever in the world. But I found them, and they've been great. The FAAN has been great.
It's just been a huge support because, you know, you have your friends and you have your family, and they all have empathy for you. But it's not the same as somebody who lives your life, your challenges, and your, you know, the little paper that you wrote and you put on Facebook the other day. I mean, it's like, it's our life. It is our life completely to a T. And people just don't get that, like the girls here. And it's just nice to be able to be a part of something that's not only benefiting our children, but other children in the community that have the same disability that our children do. So it's huge.
FAAN's met really a big piece of everything. They've made it possible for Lily to go to the movies, where that wouldn't be possible normally. And there's no rules with FAAN. It's really nice. There's no one telling your child what they can't do. It's all about what they can do and cheering you on to the next step. And very fortunate to be part of FAAN, and they've done awesome things for me. So great group of ladies, and yeah.